All right, ladies and gentlemen, after a slight delay, Smark Show number 6, the go-home show, if you will, since Brawl has them. Anyway, whatever. Nick Trichome.
Steve Herman, what's up?
Mike Cap, and I blame Steve Herman for both of the delays.
Sorry, man. School.
Trying to make something of your life, you loser.
I'm sorry, guys. You know, I'm trying to be a teacher, so, yeah.
I, too, have obligations.
Yes, you do. Yes, you do.
Okay, so, Night Champions talk. We are a couple days away. We were recording this on Friday night.
That's right.
So, we'll definitely have a lot to talk about that, but first, gotta throw some headlines at you guys.
Headlines!
You get ready, because these lines are pretty headed, so...
You're darn right.
Prepare yourself.
All right, so first, Tough Enough's final is ZZ.
Was
seen at the Performance Center working out with other developmental people.
This guy looks like Bray Wyatt, but with blonde hair.
So okay, if you want to describe it that way. Anyway, Tough Enough finalist was at the Performance Center. Probably the only contract. Anyway, the point is, the top four people from that show are working with the WWE in some capacity.
Yeah, good for them.
What's the over-under that the ZZ guy actually, like, does anything?
Probably a lot.
I have no idea. Honestly, so, I don't
would be,
much.
I'll tell you what, if he makes it, someone's pretty rich.
I heard every time a Tough Enough contestant fails in the WWE, an angel gets its wings.
That's a bit harsh, but okay.
Well, hey, I agree.
Got a lot of angels out there because of WWE, so...
Interesting way to put it, but all right. Moving on to something much bigger, I guess.
Yeah,
that's the right way to put it. Hulk Hogan spoke to Sports Illustrated and went into a little bit of detail about the whole process of resigning from the WWE. Basically, he called Triple H and said, "Hey, this tape's about to come out, and I said some very bad things." And he's like, "All right, I'll go talk to Vince." Triple H called Hulk back, and it was just like, yeah, so Vince said you gotta resign.
Yeah.
And, yeah. And a little bit after that, you know, word got out that there anyone affiliated with the WWE should not talk to Hulk Hogan.
Pretty much.
So, yeah, that whole
He's getting the Benoit treatment and Punk treatment at this point. So, it's fine. You know, gotta do what you gotta do.
The whole thing is a mess, really, in the worst possible way.
Yeah, it doesn't look good.
Next up, remember Colt Cabana's podcast with CM Punk?
Yeah, The Art of Wrestling, if I'm not mistaken, that's what his podcast is called.
Back in November, told a whole story about his departure from WWE.
Let's stop this cross-promotion. We don't want anyone tuning into that.
Oh,
everyone, come to the
You want to come to the Smart Show, I apologize. But...
Shots fired at Colt Cabana.
Oh.
Colt, you're all right with me, but...
Or Scotty Goldman. Hey-oh, no one knows that except me. He used to be in the WWE as Scotty Goldman. But back to the story the doctor.
So, anyway, after that, Dr. Chris Amon filed a lawsuit, a defamation lawsuit, and recently CM Punk and his attorney filed a response to it. It's a lot of legal mumbo-jumbo that we aren't really experts in. So, yeah, you kind of got to let the legal process play out there.
Pretty much. We'll see what happens maybe later on this year.
Yeah, anyway, there will be a conference about the case on October 9th. So, should hear more about that then. Anyway, also Hulk Hogan and kind of CM Punk related. I'll get into that in a second. But the most important part is TNA doesn't have a TV station anymore.
Yeah, that's big. I mean, you know.
Again.
Granted, you know, TNA, we all trash it because it's not a great product. But, you know, it's another wrestling company. People are losing jobs. So that kind of stinks for the wrestling business overall.
Sports Illustrated coming up big again. Interview with Dixie Carter.
Yeah, just...
Sports Illustrated had a big week wrestling news-wise, I think.
Yeah, they did really nice. They did a nice job covering WWE, surprisingly.
Yeah, two big stories there. But anyway, so Dixie Carter drops in the interview that, we're not going to be on Destination America anymore past this year.
Yeah, I don't think anyone was surprised. They were releasing guys left and right, so.
But also in that, she talked about her wanting to work with CM Punk and bring him into TNA.
Well, that's
which has next to no chance of happening.
That has no chance at all. Right, Mike?
Oh, definitely not. I don't think CM Punk wants anything to do with wrestling in general.
Yeah, for a long time, at least.
And she also talked... she also dropped a quote about why she didn't want to work with Paul Heyman because he wouldn't be able to recreate what ECW was for TNA. And
That's a slap in the face to Paul Heyman. So that's all you got to say about that. I mean, Dixie Carter does not deserve any more of our time after I just heard.
Yeah,
that.
I honestly, I don't know why we get so worked up about TNA when I'm not really sure it's worth it.
It's really not. I can't believe this is like the second story we've already had of TNA. It's our sixth episode.
This might be our last.
This might be the last.
Take a round of applause. We'll get a little sound bite for you guys.
unless the Hardy Boys or Kurt Angle return to WWE, and then we'll have to say like they came from that.
Yeah.
Or came back from that, but
it doesn't matter.
So, on the WWE 2K16, you hype?
Oh, I'm hype. The roster's huge. Mike's hype.
While the roster's been finalized,
yeah,
Enzo and Big Cass are in. They put out a video of their intro.
It's up to your opinion.
As bad as, as much as I hate to say this, it doesn't look good in the game. It doesn't.
You're the biggest video game critic here, so.
Cap, do you have an opinion on it?
I'm excited to see them,
but
yeah. Well, but like, there was some surprising people that aren't in it.
Well,
like,
that's Bailey, the big thing. Sasha, the four horsewomen are not in it.
But like, and everyone else is. Like, the vaudevillains, like, how are they in it but not the girls?
It's got to be some ploy for DLC package or some
way. I just read a report that they're not going to have one.
Yeah,
it doesn't make sense.
They have to at some point.
I know.
Maybe not right now, but the way that they've been glorifying them, even though they actually haven't been on the main roster. But
don't get me wrong. I like the vaudevillains and Enzo and Big Cass. I love Enzo and Big Cass. But these divas are like part the reason NXT is NXT and how big it is. I mean, yeah, they are part of it too. But I mean, they should get some inclusion in this video game. Yeah. It's the biggest roster they've ever had.
We were talking about it before too. It seems like divas are almost an afterthought on the video game circuit. As not, I mean, you could say it on TV too. The fact that we talk about that there's a Divas Revolution means that they definitely were in the back at some point, even if they're not right now. So, I think the video game, it's been in production for over a year before this whole Divas thing started. So,
right.
I think they just put the roster out without them, and we're just going to move forward with
it. Very interesting names, though.
But the dev team did say that they tried to get them in, and it just didn't work out. At least that's what's getting out there. But Sasha Banks also said that she was scanned for the game, so they have the assets there to make the character model.
Wait, the other thing, Alexa Bliss is in the game.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Now, how does that make sense?
It might, all that...
No offense to Alexa Bliss,
all that put together, even though they're saying there's no DLC right now for them, if she's scanned and it's the Four Horsewomen, they're going to be in it at some point.
And Eva Marie?
You know, the game's not even out yet, so they have more than a year until the next game comes out. So at some point, they're going to have
it. I don't care. Eva Marie's in the game, and they're not. That's just a slap in the face.
I think going by WWE backstage stuff anymore, Eva Marie would be put in before Stone Cold. All right,
we're getting off topic with that. Moving on.
Screw Eva Marie.
Yeah.
All right. Fine. Anyway, game still looks really good.
Yeah.
Definitely a step up from last year.
Oh, it looks fantastic. I'm definitely going to get it.
And screw Eva Marie.
All right.
Amen to that.
Okay. Moving on from that, NXT TakeOver London on December 16th.
Yep, already sold out.
Sold out. 10,000-plus seat arena.
It's 12,000.
SSE arena. NXT's good.
Yes, it is. They're going to make that hype. It's in London. London's such a good wrestling crowd, so that should be cool.
Yeah, I remember in the Quidditch tournament in Harry Potter. I think that was also held in London. That was a pretty good crowd. There was, you know, fairies and all types of stuff. So.
Dude, that wasn't in London, man.
Whatever.
Back Street. Harry Potter ran through a wall.
If it's not America,
world.
If it's not America.
Into another world.
I don't want it.
I saw the start time for it. I think it'd be 3 o'clock because they're going to start there at 8 since it's a 5-hour difference.
Yeah, it reminds me. Screw Eva Marie, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Screw Eva Marie. Totally agree with that.
It's a good way to wrap up that story.
Is this going to show, like, keep popping up for the entire show?
No, I'm going
to
make you hate it.
You know, we just really, really like Eva Marie, guys. All right.
But yeah, anyway, London, good job. NXT's awesome.
Yeah, NXT just keeps bigger and bigger and internationally.
You guys are going to love it there.
Yeah, it's going
to
be sick.
See if you can hold a candle to that Brooklyn crowd because they were ridiculous.
They were amazing crowd. High expectations, definitely.
So yeah, we'll see if another place can take the crown from Florida.
Yeah. Full Sail sucks, as Brooklyn says.
Rivalry between the crowds now.
Yeah, interesting.
It's where wrestling's got to.
Pretty much.
I just hope like it doesn't lead to too much hijacking.
Yeah. Well, we said it before last week, especially the crowd needs to stop getting involved in the physical show. You know, chanting and stuff.
Well, freaking
funny. It can derail stuff, especially when Chicago does it with CM Punk. But
don't make yourself the star of the show.
Yeah.
Well, no, I don't mind that. I hate when they go into the they run in the ring.
Oh yeah.
Well, that's what I hate. Yeah. That's what I hate. Actually, I don't mind if they take over the crowd sometimes.
I'm not sure if it's the same arena or not, but London was the one where the guys with the dreadlocks jumped over and hit each other with a rock bottle.
Yeah,
is that the same crowd, you think? Or
it's a good question. It is. It's a good question.
Beef up that security.
Yeah, beef up. Yes, definitely.
But, yeah, good job. Good job,
London. Yeah, good job, NXT. We'll give you a nice little clap, too. All
right. So, now you're champions.
Yes.
We're here. It feels like the gap between pay-per-views is getting longer now, but
I thought this actually went pretty quick.
I was about to say, this feels opposite to me.
Yeah.
It's just, I'm so
I feel like the longest one was going from Battleground to SummerSlam.
Yeah. Definitely.
Yeah. But there was just that streak where it was just like pay-per-view, 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 pay-per-view.
Yeah. Yeah.
There were pay-per-views we didn't know existed that came out.
Yeah. Well, we had the three pay-per-views in the month and a half. That was pretty cool. It was
King of the Ring, Elimination Chamber, all these random network
Payback,
ones.
Money in the Bank, I mean.
Yeah, not complaining about the pay-per-views.
Yeah, definitely.
I am when they suck, but the attempt at putting together pay-per-views is pretty sweet.
And this pay-per-view that we have coming up, it's all sometimes usually one of the worst.
Yeah.
But but I'll give them credit. They are, the last 2 years, they've been trying to get big names to be in it so people can want to watch it. Last year was Brock, this year it's Sting. So.
And I mean, in all honesty, looking at the card, actually it has some pretty interesting scenarios set up.
See, like, the matches, like, when you see them, they look great. But the storylines are just garbage.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I have the same feel.
But every
it's like
time,
Mania.
But every time I watch the match, fantastic. It's like a good match. It's like Mania. But then the finish,
Going into Mania, you were the opposite.
I was the only one.
I was notoriously very sour on Mania this year.
I was the only one who had hopes on that.
As most fans were. I think you were in the very vast minority.
Yeah.
But,
I was the one.
I feel the same way when looking towards these, but then you look at the actual matches and, you know, you see Kevin Owens in matches, you see Sting, Seth Rollins,
John Cena,
all these
Dudley Boys, New Day.
So when you look at it,
Charlotte,
when you break it down, it looks like it's going to be great, but as a whole, the story going into it and the build-up just hasn't been...
Totally, I agree. This Co-Home Brawl was absolute garbage.
Yeah.
It was not good. SummerSlams was better.
Well, I mean, it didn't help that the Eagles game was on.
Yeah, for us Philly sports fans, that's true. But yeah.
Sorry, guys out there, you took a backseat too.
Yeah, it was our first game of the year,
Eagles
so.
This year.
No which offense.
That was also
don't
want to talk about that. So let's get right back.
Yeah, back to WWE.
Yeah. So do we just want to run down the card? Just give our thoughts on each match. Just going in story.
Let's do that.
Build up from Raw.
Yeah.
All right. So we'll start with the pre-show match: Cosmic Wasteland, Stardust, and the Ascension, versus the Lucha Dragons and Neville.
Yeah. Now, I think I'm glad and happy that they're finally using the Ascension in some type of way, and I think this is going to benefit them. So I was reading a report that this is almost like when Randy Orton brought up DiBiase and Rhodes with him as his gang, as legacy. Okay. Obviously, they're big. One's a little bit bigger, more serious. But the Cosmic Wasteland, this could be something. They could maybe all dress the same, something.
You also have that link of Cody Rhodes being with Randy Orton, and now he's the one leading the faction.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's cool that they're getting a storyline here.
I'm really excited about the Cosmic Wasteland, especially if they start adding more people. I've said it before. I think a big loss in wrestling today is the lack of, you know, dominant stables and groups of people together. That used to make wrestling so much fun, seeing all the little cliques and stuff fighting back and forth. And this is a really good foundation for them, the Cosmic Wasteland with the Ascension and Stardust.
I always like Stardust, but that's just me.
This is a gimmick, too, where there's a lot of people who are floundering, where you can just throw them some, you know, gimmick that doesn't make much sense by itself, like Stardust. But when you put them with these guys, you know, they're going to look like a real powerhouse with 4, 3, whatever, plus people.
Definitely.
Fight with the Wyatts.
But with the way you explain it, too, I mean, just say the name Cosmic Wasteland. Like, just...
It's a good team
about,
name.
Yeah.
No, but thinking about it right off the bat, to me, that says... That is more than a 3-person team.
Yeah,
that is a way.
I mean,
they thought of the name already.
I mean, they thought of the name like as soon as they debuted and everything together. Yeah. It's cool.
It's a shame that they had to do that little one-off segment with Cody Rhodes screwing over King Barrett, because I think Barrett would have fit perfectly with these guys.
Yeah,
just
Cosmic
wrestling
King
style.
You know, that would have been maybe comes back. We'll see what happens.
Think about it now, it sounds like some Mad Max
and
space
then
stuff.
Then we have Neville teaming with the Lucha Dragons, which.
typical WWE booking. Let's take a single star and throw them with a tag team, and then they'll compete together.
But, you know, it's obviously the star in this six-man tag is Neville. You know, I think they're going to really protect him here.
And that's what I'm kind of afraid about, because as we were saying, all these good things about the Cosmic Wasteland.
Well, I guess WWE we can make our picks, has too.
Just a filthy habit of building something up and getting the fans to get on board with it. And then they're like, oh, well, this is popular.
Let's time to trash it.
Let's make sure this crashes and burns in the brightest fashion.
Yeah.
I don't think it's them intentionally trying to destroy it, though. I just think it's once they capture it, they don't know what to do.
I fully agree with you. I was just, ripping on creative, because I do that whenever I get a chance
to. And, I mean, with Neville especially, I mean, we were so high on him in NXT, and he came up, and we were excited about
that. He's just going up the uprise. He's only 28 years old. This guy's going to be here for a while.
He needs Adrian back in his name, though. Adrian Neville.
That'd be fine. But he's the star out of the six, and he's going to be protected here, whatever this match goes. Just watch it. Like he's in the slow rise. You know, he's one of those characters, the underdog story. He's gonna be there.
I know, but what I'm saying is, for right now, it's just kind of he's in this stasis almost. Where
he's because he's just started out the main roster. You know, he's not like Kevin Owens. He doesn't have the promo talk like him. He's not like Sami. He's like Sami Zayn, but I think Sami Zayn can talk a little bit better. Neville needs to still work on his talking.
The crowd, undoubtedly better.
True.
However, I usually would complain about that. But I like what they're doing with Neville. I think they're doing the right thing with his booking. They're building him up very slow. It's a slow burn.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I've been saying.
So when, he eventually is in the main roster or the main belt or whatever.
Like IC belt, US.
It's going to feel more well-deserved than him just coming right out of the gate and getting it right when he becomes a singles wrestler.
Exactly.
That was what a lot of people's problem was with Roman Reigns winning that Royal Rumble, where Roman Reigns
came out of nowhere.
He'd been around for a while, just like Neville has been in NXT, but his singles build, like he was...
It was nothing.
I'm a singles wrestler. Oh, now I'm main eventing WrestleMania. With Neville, you're not going to get that backlash from the fans, no matter what at this point.
No way.
Even if they started his upward trajectory to going towards a big belt now, most people would still say, okay, he's earned himself, a spot to at least contend.
Yeah, definitely.
And matches like this is a good little foundation for him to build his career on. I just hope it doesn't come at the expense of what could be a really good stable in the Cosmic Wasteland.
So I guess we talked about it enough. I guess we can all make our picks now.
Well, actually, I probably should have brought this up before we started, but we'll just go down the match, explain our thoughts on it, and then we'll make picks at the end, because the way we did picks before this show was a very quick process.
Okay.
And, I mean, SNICK'S picks was on the first episode.
Yeah,
if anyone
SNICK'S
remembers
picks.
That, it's probably best if we save that for later.
You think?
So we'll just we'll just all run down with our picks at the very end. All
right, that's
fine. As a final thing.
I thought we'd just do it, but it's cool. Let's do it on the fly.
But, yeah, and I do want to add that above all else, Neville has a cape.
Yeah.
Bonus points for a cape.
What do we got next? Ziggler, Rusev, they got a match?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yep, with Summer Rae on the corner, no Lana anymore.
Let's get into that shit show.
Did you see the picture of Lana's scar?
Yeah, it's pretty disgusting.
That's a scar.
Yeah, she got surgery a couple days ago. So
I also saw a picture of Lana in a bikini that wasn't disgusting, so there's always
I'm Lana's number one fan, and she is quite gorgeous.
Yeah, so...
She is a smoke show. She's the ravishing Russian for a reason.
Always good to balance stuff out.
Yeah, definitely. He should get to show the scars and show us the bikini.
Anyway, Ziggler and Rusev. Is this the finale to a feud that nobody wanted, finally?
I would like to think so. And even rumors of that ending and getting Rusev and Lana back together.
I mean, you guys know me. I'm the biggest Ziggler homer that there is. I will root for him no matter what.
But
this has been awful.
Let me pose that question to you then. Once this is over, what does Ziggler do?
That is my biggest complaint as a Ziggler's fan for his entire career.
Well,
because
why do they
use
him?
They use him to beef
why
up people.
Why did he resign
people.
There?
They use him to beef up people and make them look great because he's such a good seller. And, they build him in the midst of these great storylines. And, everyone in the storyline seems to make off and go do something except for him. And then he just flounders around until they need to build someone up again. The dude's proved enough times that he deserves a competent storyline or just something. Shouldn't not know what a performer as talented as Ziggler is going to be going into after a feud like this. They should have something clearly lined up that we're looking forward to, because he's the kind of guy who can really carry a segment if he has the right personnel.
Yeah, I agree.
I feel like, too, I mean, just remember back when they had that whole Authority versus Team Cena match, and Ziggler basically won the whole... They set it up so Ziggler won the whole thing by himself, basically.
Yeah.
Somebody thought that was...
Like, that should have been the point where Ziggler just goes up. Like,
yeah,
he's at the top of the mountain.
Should have won, like, the Royal Rumble and main evented WrestleMania.
Yeah, but since then, it's just been, you know, ups and downs. And, I mean, that's how you find your way in the business.
That's not WWE booking as a whole anymore, though. It's just even Stevens booking, you know?
Yeah. I feel like Ziggler's going to be at a very pivotal point after this feud wraps up because, I mean, there were reports a while back before...
He's resigned.
Yeah, but before he resigned that he was thinking about leaving. I mean, even though he signed, like, that's never really taken off the table. So...
I don't think... He would have left if he was ready to leave.
Yeah, if he resigned, it was for a reason. Yeah. I think they have to have something for him.
He's not going to leave, like, after he just signed a contract, like, a month ago.
Yeah, especially...
And he doesn't have any problems.
When you look at the landscape of other companies for wrestling that aren't WWE, do you really want to turn down that six-figure paycheck that they're guaranteed offering you?
Yeah.
When you'd be like, oh, let me go to TNA and not get paid and then get fired, you know?
The only place he could really go to make some cash, probably like New Japan.
Yeah. I mean, who knows? He's a performer, so he could love something like that. But anyway, yeah. he's re-signed, so.
Yeah, and you know, this whole storyline's just been horrible, you know, like... Like this past week on Raw, it was Cesaro and Rusev, and Ziggler comes out with a gift for Summer now. Like, what? Yeah. And like he was just like saying he wasn't kissing her and seducing her, yada yada yada, and all that stuff.
That whole storyline just got really awkward, really fast.
Cesaro won the match, and then he super kicked Rusev and stuff like that.
This is what happens.
And then she takes the gift and then looks at it. And I guess there was like some earrings or a bracelet or something. And, you know, it's just weird.
This is what happens when you have non-wrestling minds writing stories for a wrestling show. I mean, I feel like I can guarantee that they pick someone up off the, you know, Big Bang Theory or some shit, and they're the ones who wrote that story, because it's just been bad.
I did hear a rumor that this is just, like, weakened Rusev and Lana, and I heard they're thinking about putting them back together when Lana's back.
Yeah.
I said that a while ago.
I could see how it would work just because it's a proven working point for both of them. Although I don't think Rusev needs to move away from the foreign heel thing because you can get typecast in that so badly in the WWE where...
Rusev just needs... We need something fresh with a new feud with him or something.
I would love to see Rusev and I was actually talking crap about it earlier, like Kane and Daniel Bryan when they did their thing. They need to put Rusev in a situation like
that. So you want him in a comedy role?
Not a full comedy role, but just something where the fans can connect to the like Rusev more as a character. Like,
you want him to be a face?
Like,
that's kind of like a face.
Well, I feel like more like a tweener, like kind of like a Kane when he was first around where... Kane wasn't like completely a heel, but he was someone that the crowd wanted to kind of root for, but they wanted to feel him out for a little. I think you need to put Rusev with someone that the crowd knows and, you know, connects well with, just so we can get more of a feel for him. Because when I think of Rusev right now, I think of foreign heel. Like, does anything else really come to your mind? Like, he's a foreign heel. He's very generic.
Face flag.
They need to... the face flag's awesome.
Lots of tanks.
They need to give him something to build a character upon, and this just isn't working right now.
Speaking of the tank, that's it. All his entrances from now on, he rolls in on the tank from WrestleMania.
Just in a tank?
That'd be perfect.
His finisher is he just hops in a tank and just kills people with a tank. Like,
just blows up the ring.
That's an actual finisher.
That is the ultimate burial in wrestling, ladies and gentlemen.
WWE just became Mortal Kombat.
I think the matches, too, like, they haven't been great either. They're okay. I've seen better for both.
Well, you brought up, you know, I'm sure that wasn't your intention, but the idea of bringing him into this more comedic role. And here, the thing about that, like, thinking about, like, he could fit into that.
He could.
But at the same time, like, he's a big guy. He's pretty intimidating. Like, you kind of need to have him in the role where he can be taken seriously.
But that's, like, a downgrade, I think. Yeah. This comedian role, whatever.
My thing, Rusev, like, from the couple times that he's been given the opportunity, he's proven that he's extremely funny.
Yeah, he is.
However,
and he can speak pretty well.
That's a bad thing for your career in the WWE because, well, maybe not back in the day, but anymore, the second that you, like, prove that you're funny, they're like, oh, okay, well, let's stick a hat on you and give you a banjo, and you're going to dance for a year until, the people don't react to you, and then we're going to fire you. Like,
remember, like, Tenzai? Yeah. Sweet Tea?
Yeah, Tenzai and Brutus Clay. Big idiot. Brutus Clay. Brutus Clay. There you go.
They're two right there.
Yeah, perfect example, and it's very recent. You do not want them to think that you were just nothing but funny because goodbye to your career at that point in the WWE.
Santino Marella was able to make a pretty good run out of it.
Was Santino Marella going to do much else, though? It seems like he was just gripping on to whatever the hell they would give him.
He won quite a few championships. He won the IC belt, the US belt, and the tag belt.
Santino Marella?
I'm just saying he won them.
He did, but...
The Miz won them, too.
Does that really mean I'm not trying to, like, be on Santino's side, but... He's got some accolades. I mean, he was...
Comparison? The accolade there? You trying to... subliminal messaging?
Yeah, check it out.
But yeah, either way, I don't want to see Rusev in a straight comedy role, just because...
Exactly, that's what I thought you were saying.
His career just goes right down from there.
Yeah. You know, it's not... All right, well, it was funny, but, like, funny in the coolest way possible. Tanks.
And I did call this a while. If he goes comedian role, it's definitely a burial. Yeah. I said this, like...
Now, like
last year, John Cena was going to be the one to start it.
Yeah, a comedian role can... I don't want to like sound like I'm trashing comedy in the WWE, because it can work.
Like
you have
the
to
New
be,
Day?
You have to be well-established beforehand, where you know you have something to fall back on if the comedy role does or doesn't work. And Rusev doesn't really have that, so I'm saying he's Rusev, Russian heel, or whatever, Serbian, Bulgarian,
whatever.
He
can also be
in
heel and
he
like make it a different way, too.
Yeah.
You know?
Just do something with the guy. Give him a character.
Exactly.
And get him the hell away from Ziggler.
Yeah, so I'm not expecting much from this match. Just want the storyline to pretty much end. You know?
I'm just wondering, too, like, when Lana finally does come back from surgery, and, you know, the logical thing would be that, you know, she pairs back up with Rusev. What if she just comes back and she's just using a regular English accent?
I will bet you, like, $1 million that won't happen. But that's
American accent.
She will not use American accent. I don't see it.
Yeah.
That would be jarring.
That'd be great if she just came back with, like, a broken English, but, like, Oriental for some reason. Like, now she just speaks like she's, like, Korean. That's her new gimmick.
That would make zero sense.
Every time she goes
That's WWE
she just comes
for
back.
You.
Oh, yeah, now I'm from Guam.
She's from a different country every week.
They did that with D'Lo Brown when he won the European title back in the Attitude Era. He would announce that he's hailing from a different country every week.
D'Lo is awesome.
Yeah.
But yeah. Anyway, please wrap up this story at this pay-per-view. WWE, if you're listening, we don't want to watch it anymore.
Yeah, wrap this
feud
up, please.
Send them both to greener pastures, not near each other.
Yeah, let's think we're going to get a title shot.
And
please.
Speaking of title shots, right. Kevin Owens and Ryback, there's another match.
Yeah, this is one of the more anticipated matches, for me at least. I really look forward to this one. And the feud only happened like a week and a half ago, too. So
I'm a big fan of both of those guys.
So am I.
I know a lot of people, especially a lot of people who will call themselves Smarks and whatnot, like
the,
just take every every opportunity they get.
IWC, which is kind of like me.
Yeah,
but.
They crap on Ryback and, he's not the British Bulldog or Owen Hart out there.
But you know what?
He's not hitting every move crisp. Yeah, okay, whatever. You
can't ever have every guy like that,
you
know?
The WWE.
It's different.
Especially now, more than ever, needs people like Ryback. Like, as we were saying, even with Rusev, and he doesn't have that appeal of a big monster anymore. Who are their big monster heels? You know, back in the day...
Big Show.
Back in the day, it was, you know...
No.
No.
When Vince McMahon was seemingly running more of the daily operations and everything.
Right.
Everyone on the roster was 6'8" plus and 350 pounds of muscle.
Braun Strowman.
Yeah, okay. He's the only one.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They need more
Looking
of them.
The
Brock Lesnar's never around anymore, you know? We're not going to see him.
What about Big E?
Kane comes back as the cool king.
What is it? He's got thigh muscle meat on lock or whatever Xavier Woods was saying. Just the crazy stuff Xavier's yelling. But yeah, anyway, Ryback.
Yeah, back to the whole.
Big fan of Ryback. Sorry for that tangent there. Big fan of Kevin Owens. I think Kevin
Huge
Owens.
Huge fan. I have a Kevin Owens shirt on right now.
Kevin Owens' style of fighting is going to work perfectly with Ryback's style.
I'm really interested because like it reminds I hope it goes better than the Ryback-Wyatt match because I thought that was really good this past year, too.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, Ryback's been, like, as I said, like, Ryback's been surprising me. Like, every opportunity he's been given to step up, he's been doing it. I mean, look at this time a year ago where Ryback was, and then look at where Ryback is now.
He was in Ryback'sel.
Yeah, so Ryback's really taken leaps and bounds. He's gotten better at wrestling, gotten better on the mic, the fans connect
to him. This past week, though, people were criticizing him a little bit for this promo, but...
Yeah,
but he has gotten a lot better, and I totally agree.
Bray Wyatt's had some terrible promos, too, so...
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I'm just saying Ryback has really stepped up. I agree. they were talking about this promo, and like I thought he was fine, honestly. But like, you know, people are gonna nitpick him and stuff, you know.
My fear with this is another situation where I really would love both guys to win. Kevin Owens, his whole character is really based around chasing the gold and getting things that are, you know, as he says, like, gonna make my family more well off.
Yeah.
And Ryback has just been on a pretty decent run with this IC belt, his first gold in the WWE. I don't want to see it stripped away just like that.
He has had it since May, though.
But who has he fought? Big Show and Miz. You know, he really hasn't had a chance to really shine with some top tier opponents.
Yeah, but
that's why I'm hoping. I think I'm leaning towards, you know, I would love for a Ryback win over Kevin Owens, but either way, it's going to be a fun match.
Yeah, this, I think, could be a match of the night, in my opinion.
These are the type of matches you look forward to as a fan. You don't know what's going to happen.
Exactly. And it's a good face-off. It's two young guys getting a fend-off with each other in this competitive match for the IC belt.
Yeah.
So, I mean, this will be the beginning of the IC belt being credible.
Yeah, they definitely were moving towards that.
And you know what?
Brian.
I will give Big Show and Miz credit here. I'm giving Big Show credit here, ladies and gentlemen. That triple threat match at SummerSlam wasn't too bad.
Oh, yeah. Definitely not bad.
It wasn't bad. That was a good Intercontinental
significantly
match.
Significantly better than I thought it was going to be.
I agree.
So, yeah. But I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, definitely.
At the end of the day, I'm looking forward to
it. Should be a match in the night candidate for sure.
Another match that I am really looking forward to, and the mystery involved in it, is the Wyatts.
Yeah, this
versus two-thirds of the Shield and mystery teammate.
This is going to be really interesting.
All right, so do we talk about the rumors on who the mystery teammate could be? Savio Vega.
I say all of us right now, we make a pick of who you think it's going to be. Who you think it's going to be? Take a guess. Because I have theories.
Savio Vega.
You think so? Okay, all right, well, you're obviously out.
Great colleague.
I'm really not sure. I think I've been hearing rumors that it's going to be Chris Benoit. Anybody else?
Name drop.
This
podcast is over, guys. It's over.
So we acknowledge his existence then.
This has been a decade-long angle worked by the WWE to build up for Chris Benoit's return at Night of Champions in 2015. So
why cat?
Rabid Wolverine.
But no, in all seriousness,
who do you honestly think?
There's two people that I can't really choose, but like between who I think would fit for it. Baron Corbin, I would love to see up there. I think it's a little too fast for him to leave NXT, but I wouldn't be mad. And Samoa Joe, for obvious reasons.
Now, with this storyline, I think overall, this has to be a big guy.
Yeah, definitely.
He's been saying the whole time, Eric Rowan. I don't think that's going to happen now, because they would have announced it last week, because Roman said on Miz TV with the Wyatts, he said, we have our third guy, but they didn't announce it. You think he would have came out then? It's obviously a huge guy. It has to be.
That's the typical crap booking, though, that I expect from WWE.
I know. I don't want
all
to
this,
be Rowan, though.
All
I
this
want
build up, and then you hear Eric Rowan's unfitting theme song.
I want Rowan to go back to the Wyatts.
I'm in the same camp as you 100%.
Exactly, and he doesn't think...
You can't blame him, though, because some reason, WWE doesn't seem to think that more than three people can exist in a stable.
Yeah. If that happens, I'm really going to poop on that match.
The crowd will be pretty pissed, though, right, if Eric Rowan...
Yeah, party pooper.
If Eric Rowan comes out, the crowd's going to be noticeably upset, I'm sure.
Exactly.
And that's not even a slight to Eric Rowan. I actually like Eric Rowan.
So do I.
I think he would be a really good mid-card heel.
But the way they're building it up, though, this match, it just has to make you think it's going to be a huge guy.
It's like if anyone short of Stone Cold walks out
so
there,
you,
the way
you
that
say,
they've been talking about
you're saying
it.
Samoa Joe or Baron Corbin?
It has to be for me, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. How about you?
Right. Logically, maybe not, but that's what I want.
Give. Who, number one pick? Can't have two. One pick.
Who I want or who I think?
Who do you think?
Who I think, Samoa Joe.
Samoa Joe, really?
Yes.
That would be pretty sweet.
I
would like that.
I think
that.
It would be a cool little pop. It would get the audience on the main roster.
And it's ironic because it is in Houston.
Yeah.
NXT is in the Texas area.
That's what I'm saying.
Good point.
You know, we all, you know, I'm sure most people listening to this as well know very well who Samoa Joe is. But a lot of people on the main roster who watch that aren't going to really know who he is.
That'll be a good showcase for
him. He's not been a big WWE guy or anything. So him coming out with arguably the most over guy on the roster in Dean Ambrose and the most over corporate guy on the roster in Roman Reigns.
Yeah.
rubbing elbows with them in his first appearance on the main roster, that's not going to be too bad of a spot.
Not at all. It'll be a good one-night spot for him, I think.
So, yeah. So, I think Samoa Joe.
That's you? Okay. Nick, how about you?
Yeah, so I can see the reasoning behind both of Cap's ideas. And, I mean, I could say more of the same. But I've read some stuff saying, you know, it could be guys like Kane or Orton and everything. Now, you saw Chris Orton. Benoit. Damn it, Cap. But, yeah, you saw Orton a few weeks ago talking to him backstage on Raw to tease that it could be him. Obviously not him.
And then Jimmy Uso in SmackDown, and he got destroyed, so it's not going to be him, obviously.
Right.
The way they're booking it, too.
Now, this came out pretty recently, just a rumor circulating online. It's a rumor, nothing more than that right now.
Yeah, it's not official.
But it wouldn't be shocking if it happened. Yeah. It would not be shocking. Jericho.
I could see it. I mean, the way... And he's had a feud with Wyatt at this point last year.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it would make sense.
Also,
it's not like them to reach back into their bag of tricks, though, but that would be cool.
But I feel like that's the thing that's trying to entice us with this pay-per-view. Like, maybe there's a surprise or something, you know?
Also, Shayna Mack might come back.
Yeah. Maybe Chris Benoit.
Also, it's been a while since we've seen the jacket. I want to see the jacket.
Yeah.
Maybe some well, he was on Japan, but that was not the mainstream one, so it'll be interesting to see if he does come back. But my pick, this is, I think, crazy if it happens. I thought of three guys, but I'm settling with my pick. I think it's going to be The Rock.
Okay.
I think it's going to be The Rock. It's too much of a big deal for this.
Yeah.
That you know what I mean?
I would definitely not be opposed to see the Great One
exactly.
in the ring.
I just, because especially...
It's Rock's cousin.
It's Rock's cousin, especially with the rumors of Rock and Triple H this year. That could, I don't know, I just feel like that could be the start of something.
Storyline-wise, that would be a cool way to really start to sever Roman Reigns and Dean Ambrose, if the rumors
that's
are true.
That's my pick.
That one of them, you guys have heard that too, right?
What's that?
You know, the rumors with Roman Reigns and Dean Ambrose, they were talking about turning one of them.
Right.
So, you know, if The Rock comes back and they want to keep Roman Reigns' face, which seems to be their prerogative at this point, be a good way for them to shine the spotlight on Roman and his cousin, and then Dean is yet again the left out guy.
That's true.
So that could be cool.
I had two other guys, but I wanted to go with The Rock instead. One would be really awesome, though.
All three of those picks right there, though, I would not be mad with any of them happening.
Rock, Jericho, and Samoa Joe.
Yeah.
I'd go nuts for all three.
But since we suggested it here, it'll probably be
Eric Rowan.
Yeah.
So much for that.
Yep. Nah, man, Jericho.
I hope so. Jericho. That'd be cool.
Maybe.
Lights go out. The jacket appears.
Here's a good one. Drum roll. Eva Marie.
You killed it.
I'm going home, guys.
Steve looks like I just
podcast
shot
over.
But yeah, anyway, any one of those three would be pretty sweet. I'm looking forward to this match regardless. Strowman's been booked like an absolute monster.
Seth Rollins.
Yeah, all right.
Oh my God. Triple duty.
But Strowman has been booked like an absolute monster, so that would be really cool to see him versus
I think this is
going to
be a really good match. It's going to get time because they've been booking it as one of the main matches of the night. So I hope it lives up to expectations. I hope it's a surprise that I don't know about.
Yeah.
Someone that'd be great if like there's something like the
Dudley Boys. I'm definitely gonna stay off the dirt sheets now that the podcast, you know, we're recording it right now. We don't
it's
even
Friday.
Know much more.
It's two
I think
nights
I'm
away.
I'm just gonna stay off of them just so I don't ruin it for myself because surprise returns are awesome.
Especially the best one this year was obviously the Dudley Boys.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Well, Kevin Owens' debut was pretty good too.
Even Marie's debut was pretty sweet too. Wasn't a surprise, but it was
stop. All right. Please stop.
That is too much Eva
this
Marie.
This is the last time I will mention Eva Marie. Eva Marie sucks.
That's it. No more.
There we go.
Yeah.
She probably will never even know this exists, but I feel bad that we're ragging on her.
Hold on. I feel not bad at all. I just think it's getting... I don't want to hear it. I just don't want to hear her name. That's the problem with me, guys. All right? But on to the next match, I guess.
Speaking of great divas, we have a divas match for the title. That is the match that we had on this Monday Night Raw.
Yeah. Oh, God. I am ready for this
one. You won't
one.
Twist a knife anymore, Cap.
I am going to crap all over this Nikki Bella girl, whatever. That match on... I don't care right now. I am spitting.
Girl? As opposed to what?
I don't know.
That was just a poorly constructed sentence.
Whatever. Just overall, this build up, I mean, to this match, okay, it's been all right. But then they had the championship match Monday night.
Yeah, we had
it. The season premiere of Raw, guys. We weren't even talking about it. It was a season premiere of Raw.
We had some delays as we were talking about, so we didn't get a Raw show out this week, but we have to really get into this that happened on Raw.
Big time. Big time. I have a lot to say about this.
This might be one of the most awful things that's happened on Raw in
First and foremost, I lost my bet.
What was your bet?
The 1 second thing.
I forgot about that.
If Charlotte beat Nikki with one... No, you were going to buy me 5 rounds.
No, it was 4.
I said 5.
No, you said 4.
I said 5.
Well, go back to the old podcast and listen to it. Smark Show, guys.
I said 5 for a few. I think it was
whatever,
a few.
4 or 5. It's not the point.
Okay, so be more another specific match we're having on the champions.
That's beside the point.
Just got booked. Cap. Steve versus Nick. We're going to need you guys to send in your opinions on who's going to win this one.
And what kind of stipulation? Tables match, TLC match?
4 beers, 5 beers? What's going on
tequila,
here?
Tequila, vodka.
Good old-fashioned barroom brawl.
I'm down. Yeah,
Nick lost his bet, and...
I'm sad.
I think all of us lost our faith in this Divas Revolution right here with this match.
I mean... You want,
we haven't even gone into it yet, and I'm really mad talking about it.
So let's just get into it. Let's...
All right, okay, so the match, you know, it was, it was all right. Charlotte looks great, of course, because she's a women's wrestler. Nikki Bella is a diva, and that's all she is, ladies and gentlemen. I don't care.
Getting up close to the mic there, man.
Absolutely.
Getting fired up.
I am fired up. This is garbage, okay? So Alicia Fox is, you know, distracting, typical heel move, referee sees her. Nikki falls to the side, same old crap, twin freaking magic. Then she pins Brie Bella, they win. Well, Charlotte supposedly wins the Divas title, and Ric Flair comes out, Becky Lynch comes out, Paige comes out. They're like, yip, doo, woo, woo, woo. Ric Flair does his woo chants, and then all of a sudden, Bray's showing her stuffage for her bra and stuff, whatever you call that stuff.
Stuffage.
New word of the week. Toilet paper. There we go. Okay, she's throwing it out. But she did this like 2 months ago at Money in the Bank, and it got disqualified. It was the same crap. And then good old Stephanie McMahon has to come out. She's like, You take it from here, the integrity of the women's division or the WWE and crap like that.
I'm not going to have that tarnished.
So. It's already tarnished.
All right, it's not that it's tarnished. I saw that and just went, wait. So you're saying there are clearly written rules?
Like, she pinned her. She should have won the match. It doesn't matter.
Well, yeah. She pinned the wrong person.
It doesn't matter.
It kind of does.
It's heel, you know, you gotta...
No, I don't care. Nope.
I'm writing it off from, like, an intelligence standpoint, although I'm sure that they didn't even factor this in.
Garbage.
You know, technically, there was a DQ, so DQ goes to the champion. That's what lines up the match that we have at Night of Champions, you know, where any DQ this time
count
goes
out
to the
or
challenger.
Yeah.
So, you know...
But all I'm gonna say, I have to say is one word. Politics, ladies and gentlemen. And that is what we felt last night, is just... Monday night, whatever.
Yeah.
You know what I meant.
Paige actually sent out a tweet or something, I remember saying. Something about like, oh, well, I don't think that this was anything to do with a jab at CM Punk or something along those lines.
It definitely was.
I didn't read the whole thing because I don't feel
it is so obvious.
Shit shoved in my ears.
It's so obvious because then Stephanie came out to make the big announcement because she's probably been waiting for this since AJ Lee tweeted at her. And, you know, I'm not the biggest AJ Lee fan in the world. I liked her a lot, but, you know, it's just Nikki Bella... is just her title wins are just horrible. She can't act. She's a horrible wrestler. She's improved, but she's not great.
You see a lot of articles and stuff post Raw this week where people are like, this has been magnificent booking, turning Nikki Bella into one of the biggest heel champions the WWE has seen in years. And I wholeheartedly disagree with this. She's not getting CM Punk, Dolph Ziggler heel heat. She's getting X-Pac heat where people just don't want to see her.
They don't
care. She's not a good heel character. She's a person that we don't like, you know, just in general. We don't want to see her as Divas champion. I'm speaking for myself but I'm sure there's a lot of people who agree with me. I just don't want to see her. She doesn't bring anything interesting to the table. All they do is they revert back to this, you know, twin magic thing whenever this stupid creative team,
Big Show and Kane.
Yeah, like, you know, they'll flip them heel, face, whenever it's relevant to their story. It's just terrible. Like, I don't want to see them anymore.
And I know that I didn't want to bring her up again, but Eva Marie, Like, that's what could happen again.
Why? That's why do we keep bringing her up?
Because she's horrible, too. That's what could happen. You know what I mean with the Bellas? She's probably the next one.
Not what could happen, what has happened. Because
yes, exactly.
More importantly, why does this whole thing with the Divas Revolution... Like, if this happened 5 years ago, I have a... Like, with what they had then, and they were trying to pull this stuff off, I have a hard time same way as we do now.
Yeah, I wholeheartedly agree with you, yeah.
Like, if they were trying to pull the... Who was on the Divas roster like five?
Kelly,
Eva Torres, Caitlyn.
Michelle McCool,
Layla.
Yeah. I mean, Michelle McCool.
Melina,
was all
right. Alicia Fox.
No, but yeah, I know what you mean.
But I mean, like, you have people now that are, like, clearly good, really good at what they're doing.
Not even just, like, the best women wrestlers. Like, some of the best wrestlers they have on their roster, yes. Like, men included.
Absolutely.
Shout out to you, Bailey.
Shout out to you, Sasha.
Shout out to you, Becky.
Shout out to you, Charlotte.
Team Gadget.
And no shout out to you, Bellas. We hate you.
yes, right. Yes.
Taking it that far.
Yes, yes.
Anyway, like, I guess we got our...
No, we're really... Just the booking of this was garbage. Like, I think I would have been okay with this if Nikki won clean, honestly.
Yeah.
Or, like, it was kind of cheap, but not Twin Magic.
Oh, that's what I said earlier.
The thing they just did was horrible.
That's what I said earlier. It's even Stevens booking all the time in WWE anymore. You know, if you're going to go with a heel as champ or whatever, like, you don't have to always make the babyface come out like, oh, well, they just got away from me, or vice versa, whatever. You have to book people as dominant at some point, and that's been the whole thing with Nikki's title reign that has pissed a lot of us off that it beat AJ's, because she doesn't defend the thing.
You know what the other thing...
She fights, but it's never for the title.
You know what the other thing was horrible about that? Charlotte, they ruined the moment of Charlotte winning the title.
Yeah.
For the first time ever. She's like going nuts. That was just a horrible booked situation.
Yep.
They could have done. They could
Shades of Dean Ambrose versus Seth Rollins. Yeah.
And here's the.
But thing. I think it's even worse than that.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely.
Here's the thing. Now to turn it into the night champ or to turn it over to the night champions match. If Charlotte doesn't win that,
we riot.
Well, all
yes.
Right, if that's.
I will be done with the Divas. We will not talk about Divas until Nikki loses the belt.
But it makes zero sense.
What's that?
If Charlotte doesn't win.
I know it doesn't. But if she doesn't win, I'm not talking about the Divas. I will talk about NXT, but Divas, women's wrestling.
Well, I mean, and I wholeheartedly think that, I've said it before, there's no way that they can be this stupid.
They could.
They prove me wrong at every time.
I mean, Sheamus is the Money in the Bank briefcase winner.
Yeah, so, yeah.
Okay.
I take that back. But, yeah, Charlotte has to win this.
But it's just amazing.
Hands down.
Like, you know, before it, you know, it's still somewhat when they made their way up to the main roster, but... You know, recently, like, just look at TakeOver Brooklyn. That's, like, the shining example. Just what they had going on there versus what they had going up on the main roster. It's, like, this sharp contrast.
Yeah, it almost makes you not want to call it the main roster because...
It's not
especially
at all.
For women, it's not.
No,
you know?
No, NXT is where it's at, ladies and gentlemen.
I mean, even for most NXT competitors, it's not. You know, Seth Rollins has been... Who we got? Big E made it. I'm talking about NXT, like, talents who have made it. The jump from the main roster. Bo Dallas has floundered. Adam Rose has floundered. Emma has floundered. Rusev had a decent little run, but...
Oh, no, Rusev... He got a WrestleMania main match. I know I trashed Cena, but he got a match with Cena at WrestleMania. I know.
What good has that done him?
But at least he got a main match at WrestleMania.
That right there is the mindset that I think kills most up-and-comers. Oh, well, you know, he got to fight Cena, so yeah.
Oh, no.
Congratulations. Hats off.
Don't get that in my
career's in the garbage a month later because you lost to Cena, too.
Yeah.
So,
I'm not disagreeing.
There just hasn't been many that have made the jump.
Well, the Wyatts.
No, I'm not saying... I mean, you know, there's been Seth Rollins. There's been the Wyatts. Roman Reigns is still in the process.
Roman's a star.
Yeah, Roman's still in the process. A lot of the fans still hate Roman Reigns.
They do hate him, but he's a big guy. You got to realize that. We're not big fans of him, but he is a big guy. You got to realize that.
Oh, I'm not doubting that. But when I'm saying, like, made the jump, I'm saying, like, made the jump with, like, respect, like, all around.
I got you.
There's not been many of them because of the booking on the main roster. So, especially for these women, it's just hard.
Yeah, well, I think they might have made the mistake of bringing up too many at the same time. Because NXT's just so good.
Yeah, I mean...
Like, Charlotte was ready, and so they were all ready, obviously. But, you know, I felt like they should have kept two. They called two up and kept two
down.
Yeah,
I don't think Becky should have came up yet.
Yeah, I totally agree.
I definitely think Charlotte, it was time for her to come
and
up.
And Sasha was too.
I definitely think Sasha had her time to come up. Bayley is where she should be as NXT champ.
Yeah.
You know, she's the perfect champ for that. But, yeah, Becky should have stayed down. But anyway, this match, we're getting way off topic with this match.
Yeah.
Charlotte versus Nikki. Charlotte better win.
That's it.
Long story short.
Yeah, Charlotte better win. Like, no excuses. I swear, if she doesn't win.
This isn't going to be the big, oh, yeah, the baby face won, because it's not even like there's been a big story.
It's going to be a big sigh of relief.
It's just, yeah, it's not that I'm going to be.
Thank God.
It's not I'm going to be like, yeah, she slayed the villainous dragon and Nikki Bella. Like, no. Like, I just want her to win and get Nikki Bella out of the goddamn picture.
Yes. Absolutely. I cannot agree with you.
I'm
like,
so sick of the Bellas. It's not even funny.
I can't agree with you. It's not like
a Seth Rollins sick where I'm like, oh, you know, this guy's a little scumbag. I want to see Sting kick his ass.
Right. I got you.
I just want to see him gone.
All right. So on to our next match. I think.
It was like a 45 minute tangent of hate.
Yeah. Yes, it was. I guess we'll talk about New Day and Dudley Boys now. Another hype match.
Yeah.
I mean, the Dudley Boys are back, people. I mean,
it's, yeah, as we it's said, almost, if you break this card down, it's a pretty hype card. Yeah. It's just when you put it together and look at the whole product.
Well, the storylines and stuff like that, but yeah.
Here's my biggest question going in, and it's a question I don't need answered until we're actually watching the pay-per-view and see it go down. What are the New Day going to do in their entrance?
Oh, something incredible, of course.
It's going to be something ridiculous.
Something Houston-related or something, because they did with New York. That was perfect.
I'm sure we'll see a trumpet or a trombone or whatever the hell.
It's trombone, and they'll be using that all night.
That's going to be his signature thing from now on.
Oh, yeah, like when the next action figure comes out, that thing's going to be right next to it.
Oh, yeah.
I will buy that.
I think I will, too. That would be pretty cool. But, yeah, overall, I think this match has been – the tag team division has been enhanced fully with the Dudley Boys. I mean, this is going to be a great match. Like, I'm so pumped. This Dudley Boys New Day, top two teams.
Yeah, from every side, too. Like, you know, booking's been good going into it.
Absolutely.
The actual individual people in it and their stables as a whole or tag teams. Wrestler, like, these are all very talented wrestlers. Devon's probably the weakest of all of them, just off what, you know, the work that we've seen from them. But still, you know, Devon is part of a tag team that has the most titles in WWE history. So don't think he's going to flounder in a big spot.
And I think overall, I mean, you got to give some primetime players credit here. Their match on Raw. Titus O'Neil has really broke out like this second half of the year.
He has
been really impressing me.
It's kind of a shame for the primetime players that New Day has been, because as good as the primetime players have been, and they've been pretty damn good, it's just like, what can you do against the New Day?
New Day just took it to a whole new level. You know?
That's like a lamp next to some star that's exploding. Right. Like, the light right there is, it's hard to step up to them, but the primetime players themselves have been good. We might see them get involved in this, knowing WWE booking.
Maybe. This match could go either way, though. I totally agree.
Yeah, anyone can win this.
Yeah.
I could easily see them saying, oh, well, you know, the fans love the Dudleys. Let's capture this star power while we can. Give them the belt. Elevate the tag titles. Or they could be like, you know, the New Day's on fire. I think we made a mistake taking it off them the first time. Let's keep it with them and see if they run for
it. Exactly. And make the Dudleys get the title. Put the Dudleys
on their notch. That would be cool for the Dudleys, too, because the Dudleys come around, they lose. You can start the story with the New Day and antagonize them, you know, old men.
Can they do it?
You can't compete with us.
And it's not anything where the Dudley Boys have to get the tag titles right away, because we know that they're here for the long haul.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
If they want to get that belt again, they have plenty of time.
It's a milestone belt, too. If they win this, they get 10, right? The double digits?
Yeah, 10, yeah. 10 WWE.
So that's something cool.
And it'll be 25 what I'm saying is, of all time. Like,
build up to that.
Yeah, it's nothing that has to be done right away. You can save it for a bigger pay-per-view.
Mania, Rumble.
Yeah,
Survivor
anywhere.
Series, yeah.
Tag team division looking good.
Yes, it is.
All right, so now we move on to Seth Rollins' first part of night. Second. I don't know how they're going to order it. Sting probably goes last.
You would think.
We'll start with Seth Rollins.
You would think, but yeah, WWE booking.
Don't you doubt John Cena. John Cena will be the main event
Let's go with Seth and Cena.
Yeah,
here.
Let's put our little prayer hats on and hope that that is not the main event.
The
co-main event, as WWE likes to call that.
Well, they probably will call that.
So yeah. Seth Rollins versus Cena. Cena probably wins the U.S. title back.
We'll see.
He has to.
They could pull something out of their butts, though, you know?
Yeah, definitely. You can never doubt them, but...
Shocked us before with some stuff.
They didn't give it to Kevin Owens, and them not giving it to Kevin Owens really signifies that they have some plans with that U.S. belt with Cena. those open challenges, which they obviously haven't done in a long time, those were awesome. Like, that was a big reason why I wanted to tune into Raw every Monday. I was like, oh, who am I, you know?
Who's he going to fight this
week? Am I going to see Sami Zayn? Am I going to see Neville? Am I going to see
Kevin Owens, yeah. Dean Ambrose, Stardust. I was actually
really pulling for, this was before we even had the podcast, I kept saying I wanted Heath Slater to come out as he kept getting jumped when his chance.
Yeah,
Slater push. So still holding on to that John Cena wins that back and Heath Slater wins that belt. Steve, didn't me you and have a bet before too that Heath Slater would take the belt off John Cena?
Did we?
I believe we did. So I'm still holding on to that.
But yeah, I have a better one for you, Damian Sandow. But okay.
But yeah, that's gonna be a good match, I think. Cena and Rollins have stepped up.
Yeah, I mean the SummerSlam match. I watched it again. It's really good.
Yeah. I'm not a big John Cena fan by any means, but I got to give the guy credit. He steps up when he needs to.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, this will be a pretty cool match.
Yeah, yeah.
And Seth Rollins is Seth Rollins. I don't really think
Seth Rollins is money, and he's amazing. I don't think we really need to say
much about him. It's like putting Shawn Michaels in a main event and saying, oh, you know, yeah. Is he going to perform?
We'll see.
Yeah. So this is looking to be good.
I guess we can talk about the main event.
Yeah, Rollins double duty.
So... Yeah, Seth Rollins pulling double duty.
I did say
defending
this.
Defending the WWE World Heavyweight title.
Yes.
Big milestone here, too, if Sting ends up winning. He becomes the oldest champion.
Oh, he does.
That's right.
I didn't know that. That's pretty cool.
So, going into it now, you know, a few weeks ago, if there was one belt that Rollins held on to, it would be the World Heavyweight title. But now that we're getting closer, not so sure.
The storyline for this has been, God.
Yeah, I have really even started to question it, like, myself as to if I'm excited if Sting's even here anymore, and that's saying something.
My one friend from work texted me one night. He's like, dude, Sting is getting booked so bad here. And he's like, he said his TNA run might have been better than this.
Really?
He might be right.
He seems like he's like a kid's version of the TNA Joker character, like even more, like he's like, I don't know, like just nothing about him is appealing.
I mean, I did like the statue segment last week.
The only part I liked was when he pushed the statue into the thing.
Yeah.
I could have done without everything else.
It was okay, but you know.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to.
But I expect more out of Sting.
Yeah, that's where I wanted to get to. You know, I don't want anyone to take it completely away that, you know, I don't like Sting. I love Sting. But as I was saying before we came on here, this angle that they're working with is really making me question if I really like Sting. Like, Sting's history I love, but this WWE version of him's been pretty bleh, and I don't want to see that take the title from Rollins.
But, and this has been a big point between the three of us. Well, you and I, at least.
Yeah.
We don't really want to see another, you know, part-timer run around with the title.
No.
Unless it's Lesnar, because Lesnar's cool.
Yeah, I'll take Lesnar. I don't really care about that. Lesnar brings, like, an air of...
He brings prestige to the damn title.
But Lesnar's not involved in this match, so it's Sting that we have to talk about if he is the one that wins it as a part-timer, because I can't see Sting being there every week.
He's been there every week since he's been back.
Yeah, but he has a pay-per-view at the end of this. That's what I'm saying. Like,
who knows? Maybe he works
out. He's at that age.
Pay-per-views for us.
Oh, yeah. If that happens, you know.
Sting's that kind of guy that would do that. If that happens,
I'll put my foot right in my mouth and, you know, Sting, champ, I'm cool with that. Especially if they change up that cheesy character that
Sting
has
right
now.
Sting doesn't have a schedule like Lesnar's. I think it's just whenever they want him, he can come.
But, you know. I think, you know, either way, with this match, we're going to see some tomfoolery involved in the end, whether it be Triple H coming out and doing something, or Sheamus cashing in on the winner, or something. I don't think this is going to be a clean ending.
Yeah, but you know, they could just shock us, and maybe it is clean. But I totally agree with you. I think it's going to be something involved, screwy again with the WWE title.
Since we're through all the matches, we got through them all, right?
Yeah.
Might as well start our picks here.
All right.
We'll
Here's how we're going to do it. We'll go in the order that we introduced each match.
That makes sense.
Should I explain what SNICK'S picks are?
Yeah, because we had some more views a couple episodes later. You know?
All right.
Insanity,
so,
in one word.
Basically, here's... All right. Basically, here's the story behind it. Every pay-per-view, we'll go to Steve's house to watch it, and he puts a piece of paper down with all the matches on it, and we had to make picks. I never take those picks seriously. Cap just writes names. I write just
We all write names except you.
I'm not even sure how to describe it. So, I'm not sure how well it translates to audio form. Probably not well. I'll take a picture of the actual sheet itself and put it a link to it in the description so you guys can see it if you want to. but here's cool. What we'll do. We'll go through the card. Steve, you'll make your pick. Cap, you'll make your pick. And then I will try to explain whatever I wrote. Okay. So we'll start with the pre-show match, Cosmic Wasteland versus Lucha Dragons.
I'm going to go with my pick. I picked Cosmic Wasteland. I feel Stardust needs this after the loss at SummerSlam because they're having a little feud between him and Neville. So that's where I'm headed.
My heart wants the Cosmic Wasteland to win this just so we have some more dominant stables. It wouldn't be shock at all.
It's a pre-show, man, too. Yeah. You got to realize that.
It wouldn't be a shock at all to see Neville and them win, but I'm just going to go with the Cosmic Wasteland out of just hope.
Yeah, that's what I... That's
living
what
on mean. A prayer here, guys. We're halfway there.
Yeah. SNICK'S picks, first pick.
What's SNICK'S pick?
J.J. Watt.
J.J. Watt.
Whoa, all right. Because it's in Houston, Texas. If you didn't get that one, I guess.
J.J. Watt, surprise.
Which means he's going for the face team because Houston's the face. It's the home ground, obviously.
Yeah, I should also mention that anything I write has no basis to what will actually happen. Yeah, usually. Yeah.
Most of the time, unless if it's a serious match.
On the paper here, we have what appears to be the Texan symbol, but it looks like a shirt with horns, maybe? not sure.
It's a very crude version of the Texans logo.
But yeah, that's a great way for us to jump into SNICK'S picks for those of you who don't understand SNICK'S picks. He picks J.J. Watt to win the Cosmic Wasteland versus Neville and the Lucha Dragons.
That's what you get here on the Smark Show, ladies and gentlemen.
Expert analysis.
Yeah.
All right.
He knows his stuff well.
Ziggler versus Rusev.
I feel this is going Rusev. He needs a big win and the feud. Rusev needs to get back that big, being a heel, like just real good heel.
Yeah.
I don't know.
The fan of me says Dolph Ziggler.
Yeah, well, you know that.
The logic in me says Rusev, and I got to go with Rusev here. He needs the win. But that's what I was saying earlier with Dolph Ziggler when I was complaining earlier. It's like Dolph Ziggler's in this, he's almost like Randy Orton, where it's like Randy Orton just puts people over. But Randy Orton has the accolades and achievement.
And he's a 12-time WWE champion. Like,
Ziggler also needs some wins. Like, that dude can just be the star of your company if you want him to be.
Yeah, but you know.
People will say, he's got an injury history. Jack Swagger kicked him in the head and he got a concussion. Like, what are you supposed to do with that?
Right.
But anyway, Rusev.
And
Ziggler.
The second pick of SNICK'S picks.
I drew a picture of Rusev riding in the tank and he's saying Machka.
That's Rusev's theme song, and obviously he's going Rusev there.
I don't think that needs any explanation. I'm pretty sure everyone understands.
Well, they might not. I don't know. I'm just giving them some clear vision.
I'll upload a photo of the sheet so you can click the link to it in the description. See
it. Yes.
So what's our next match here?
I got New Day versus Dudleys.
New Day versus Dudleys. I'm going to have New Day winning here by shenanigans. With something with Xavier.
By shenanigans. Is that the official by shenanigans?
Yes, by shenanigans.
Okay, official ending.
Yes.
You're
welcome.
Yeah, I'm gonna go with New Day here. They've just been so good with the belts that I want them to.
We're going the same so far. I don't like this.
Yeah, so.
God, I thought we would have some different picks so far.
Me and Steve are usually rivals. And but New Day.
New Day. SNICK'S picks number 3.
Tables will break.
Which I mean, Dudleys.
Take that for whatever it's worth.
His voice. So we've got New Day, and Tables winning this one. Expert opinion.
No, Tables are not the winners here.
Sure about that.
All right, Divas title: Charlotte versus Nikki.
Charlotte.
Simple enough.
Yeah, Charlotte. I don't need an explanation.
Screw the Bellas. If she loses, we riot.
Screw the Bellas and screw Eva Marie.
Screw Eva Marie, yeah. All
right.
On to the next one.
On to the next one.
All right. If Nikki wins...
We riot.
I will break something. Probably a table.
SNICK'S picks, guys.
Hopefully the Dudleys are still hanging around.
Yeah, give her a powerbomb through the table. That'd be nice.
3D.
Hopefully a New Day doesn't take the last table. Because if they do, I will find it.
Save.
And I will tables. Break it.
Save. The tables.
You always got the Spanish announce table if they don't
mess with that one. The first Spanish announce table.
They can take one more hit for the team.
Exactly.
All right. Owens versus Ryback.
I'm going Kevin Owens. He's going to win the IC belt here, ladies and gentlemen. He's going to get his title that he needs.
This is the hardest one for me.
He's going to win.
I got to go, regrettably, team up with Steve again and say Kevin Owens. Oh,
come on. Go Ryback.
I love Ryback, but...
I love Ryback, too, but Kevin Owens needs this more.
This is who we think is going to win. It's Kevin Owens.
He's got to get it. He's got to get it.
Yeah, so I respect these guys a lot and honestly have nothing for it, so Kevin Owens.
There we go.
Yeah. Sorry, that one's a little bit of a...
That's just Nick's picks.
You know, that's a serious Snick's pick right there, ladies and gentlemen. And, you know, you got to expect that once in a while.
It's a face turn.
All right. Exactly. So, Wyatt family versus Ambrose, Reigns, and question...
Benoit. I don't... Mystery partner.
I don't care who the mystery partner is. I said it was The Rock. Wyatt family's definitely winning here. Yeah. This feud's continuing.
Yeah. Either way, the Wyatts. Same. God. Yeah. Sorry there's no back and forth blood war between me and Steve here.
Yeah, this is not good. I was not expecting this.
All right. So, first of all, if anyone's offended by Benoit's name being mentioned, I apologize.
I will drink your tears. I love it.
Cap is clearly being antagonistic here.
I'm the JBL of the team. Heel turning.
Yeah. Again, sorry if there's any offense. Anyway,
cry for me.
Cap, behave yourself.
Who is the Snick's picks here?
Savio Vega. Nah, I'm just kidding, actually.
I'm supposed to behave myself.
But you say Savio Vega? Come on, kidding. People will complain about that one.
Savio Vega is a scrub. Reigns and Ambrose started it. But anyway, no, that one's a fake out. That's not the real pick. The real pick is Reigns, Ambrose. Jericho.
That would be awesome.
All right. So we get Jericho, Reigns, and Ambrose. There we go. There's a different answer.
Yeah, a different one, to say the least.
All right. Seth Rollins versus Cena.
John Cena. Yeah,
John Cena. God. It's obvious. Can you really pick against Cena?
Like, I mean, he lost a match. He doesn't lose to Cena, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, come on.
John Cena
will be here in Philadelphia next week at the Wells Fargo Center. And the main event of Night of Champions at Houston, Texas, Sting versus Seth Rollins for the WWE World Title. And I'm going with Sting, but Sheamus cashes in. He's winning the title.
I'm not even trying to just agree with Steve here. Swear to God, that is actually what I think.
Stop agreeing with him!
I'm really not even trying to be funny.
Come on! Are you serious?
Yeah, I 100% think that this is going to be the break in the authority, finally, where they say, oh, you know, Seth, you're not the golden boy anymore, blah, blah, blah. We're jumping ship to Sheamus, or whatever, some crap.
Sheamus O'Shaughnessy.
But either way, Sheamus cashes in at the end of here. I don't think that they put much thought into the Sheamus Money in the Bank run, and I think it's better that we just end it quickly. You know, I don't want to go into Rumble with Sheamus still holding that goddamn briefcase.
If Sheamus does win it, who's his feud?
Yeah, they'll do a triple threat, obviously.
You think so?
They have to. Okay. Rollins lost the belt. Sting lost the
belt. Logically, but you know, somehow it'll all get screwed up.
Somehow Kane will be in the main event or some crap, but...
If I see Sheamus with the belt at WrestleMania, I will flip out.
But if Sheamus gets the belt, I don't think it'll be a long run at all. I really don't think...
He's a transitional one.
That's what I'm saying. I really don't think they put much thought into this Money in the Bank thing.
Which is pathetic.
I heard rumors that he was supposed to win it last year, but things got changed. Seth Rollins won it. So I think this is kind of just, you know, here you go, Sheamus. This is a Christmas present a year late. And I think they're just going to use it as a little quick move along in the story of Seth Rollins.
Because the Money in the Bank is such a big deal.
This could also be... we didn't talk about it when we were going into the matches, but this could be a face turn for Seth Rollins. Like, we could see this could be the last days of heel Seth Rollins.
Funny thing you say that, Rollins and Sheamus teamed up on SmackDown against Reigns and Ambrose, and they were doing the look, you look stupid chain, and Rollins is just chilling in the corner, like, laughing at him and stuff. Like, he's going along with the crowd now, like, yeah, a little bit. Not that much. He's like, I usually don't agree with the crowd all the time, but you do look stupid.
Yeah.
He did say that.
So, I mean, this could be the ending days of Rollins as a heel for now. Oh,
that's sad.
Yeah, he's been such a great heel. But he, I mean, the people who know his moveset, oh, him as a face is going to be beautiful to watch you said, in the ring.
We're both saying Sting wins, and then Sheamus catches.
Yes. That's very weird that me and Steve agree with so much, because
we agreed with everything.
We usually do not.
We agreed with everything.
Yep.
Little, I thought you were going to go Neville and Lucha Dragons, at least.
So,
But wait. The last pick from SNICK'S picks. Who you got?
So, I feel like it's inevitable that Sheamus tries something to cash in and win the title.
It's either
Sting wins the belt. Sting holds on to the belt. Why? Because he gets help from J&J Security.
Noble and Mercury are back.
Oh, that would be so beautiful.
I actually liked his idea for once. Like, some of them, like, yeah.
I want a J&J.
I'm like, that would be cool.
I want a J&J to be a legitimate tag team so bad when they were running around with.
They could still wrestle too, probably. That's what I'm saying. You know, they take bumps like crazy.
Yeah.
You know, but if Sheamus doesn't cash in here, it's Hell in the Cell, definitely. It's one of these two. It's one of the fall months. It's gotta be.
Yeah.
You know, we just gotta accept that. It sucks. Hopefully, he loses it. Maybe.
But either way, it's shaping up to be, you know, one of those pay-per-views that we could walk away from saying, this is the best Night of Champions they've ever had, or could go the complete 180.
Could be the worst pay-per-view of the year. Night
of Champions, or, yeah, pay-per-view of the year. The background stories leading into this, they're not looking great, but they've proved us wrong, as I said with WrestleMania earlier in the year, that was one of the best WrestleManias of all time, if not the best.
Best WrestleMania I ever watched.
So, you know, the build-up to the story isn't always as pertinent to if the matches themselves are going to be great.
Because when you have good workers, it could still outshine the storyline.
But this one is going to be one where we're just going to have to watch and see.
Yeah, I really don't have expectations for this. I'm really hyped to see Sting and the Dudley Boys, pretty much. And Charlotte better win, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm really excited to see Benoit, too, after this, you know, decade-long departure from wrestling.
Stop.
Totally. Agree with that.
All right, so again, if you were offended by any Benoit related remarks,
it's fine. It's fine.
We really apologize.
And again, I will drink your tears.
Yeah, so you now know who the heel of this podcast is. Anyway, yeah, Night Champions. Hope it's good.
Yeah, hopefully. Hopefully it's better than SummerSlam. I gave SummerSlam a C+, so I'm hoping for at least a B pay-per-view.
You always want the best show possible.
Yeah, absolutely.
They have the setup. They just need to
It's up to the performers capitalize. At this point.
Good matches and hopefully some good finishes.
Yeah, hopefully some, aside from maybe the Rollins, Sheamus, Sting, possibly Sheamus. Just clean finishes, please. Like, stop with all Just finish the goddamn feuds.
That's why I think there's not going to be a screw job for the world title match, just based on the fact the last two pay-per-views for the title matches have been screw jobs. Taker in Battleground and then Jon Stewart.
Yeah. Repetitiveness has not stopped them in the
past, They haven't. I'm just trying to be wishful thinking here, ladies and gentlemen.
I think we can call that an episode, right?
All right, let's wrap this up. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been episode 6 of the Smark Show. The go-home episode leading into Night of Champions.
Yeah, it's been a good one, guys.
You can listen to us on SoundCloud and YouTube. Give us a like if you enjoyed the show. And subscribe to get the newest episode as soon as it's ready. Also, comment to let us know your thoughts on the last week of wrestling and your predictions for Night of Champions on Sunday night as well. If you don't want to do that, you can always reach out to us on Twitter. Cap, where can they find you?
You can find me at BenoitFan69 at Twitter.
Yes.
I'm just kidding. You can't follow me on Twitter. I hate Twitter. So don't follow me. Follow Steve twice.
Yes.
Make another account. Follow Steve again.
Steve, where are you at?
I'm at Steve Herman 10.
I'm at It's Nick. Cap, you have one more announcement to make before I punch you in the face.
We talked about it last episode that we were thinking about doing some additional podcasts, and we got busy over this week, so we couldn't even get our usual Raw one out. But what we'd like to do is similar to the WWE Top 10 or Countdown series, where we just go over, you know, lists that we came up with ourselves, pertinent to WWE history. So it could be our favorite top five tag teams of all time, or it could be the best gimmick matches. It could be the most overrated main eventers or whatever. But we're looking forward to doing one pretty soon.
Yeah, pretty soon.
Possibly even before our next Raw podcast. So be on the lookout for that, too, for all of our subscribers.
Definitely
subscribe. We still have to figure out, you know, the format we want to do it in and when exactly we can do it. But
we did choose one, though, right?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, yeah, but...
Yeah, we might as well.
Why don't we announce it?
Like, how we want to...
Our first one is going to be our dream matches. The three of us are going to get, you know, our top 10 all-time dream matches.
We're all going to cram it up into one.
Yeah, we're going to agree on them, and we're just going to go down the list on, you know, why we think
why we want them to be our dream matches.
The history of the performers, whatnot. So look out for that. That'll be some pretty exciting stuff, hopefully.
Hope you guys
are looking forward to
it. We just thought of, like, 20 topics off the top of our head in, like, 5 minutes. So we have a lot to talk about in the upcoming episodes.
If you like listening to us ramble, like we did a lot on this show, you're in for a treat.
Yes, you are.
Again, and we don't want to guarantee anything just yet.
Guaranteed.
Are you both turning heel on me?
Absolutely.
All right. So
major
Michael
heel turn.
Cole over here.
Yeah, we got Michael Cole.
Oh man.
I need to be. I'm Corey Graves. Cole. That's JBL. And this is the Smark Show.
I think that's a perfect wrap up.
Man, why do I gotta be Michael Cole? That'll do it for us. Till next time, guys. Thanks for watching.
Fell off, I'm still hot, knock your shell off. My money stacked fat, plus I can't turn the swell off. The franchise doing big business, I live this, it's automatic, I win this, so you hear